Hey, what's new, guys? Well, I'm about to tell you. Welcome to the program. I'm Yvette. Africa isn't known for its snow sports, but athletes from the continent actually have a long track record at the Winter Olympics. We have the latest ahead of the Beijing Games. From ski slopes to the desert foxes, we'll find out why Algeria's Africa Cup of Nations campaign ended in disaster and hear from the disappointed fans.
We lost after a strike of 35 matches. We are sad but not disappointed. Algeria will come back stronger and stronger.
And we sit down with the Namibian singer determined to keep her mother tongue thriving through her unique music.
It's my duty, you know, to showcase my heritage, to keep my culture alive.
And welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. We're kicking off today's show with some snow and heading to the ski slopes of China. There are 8 African nations taking part in the 2022 Winter Olympics in Beijing, even though Africa is not a continent known for winter sports. But there is a long history of African athletes attending the Winter Games, as Wahiba reports.
The Olympic Winter Games Pyeongchang 2018 marked a significant milestone for African countries at the Winter Games, featuring 8 nations from the continent. But let's go back to the beginning. Over 60 years ago, South Africa became the first African nation to appear at the Winter Olympics when 4 young figure skaters represented the country in Squaw Valley in 1960. Morocco then became the next African country to feature at the Winter Games, sending a team of 5 alpine skiers. But I want to take us back a little bit further to when Africa celebrated its largest presence at the Olympic Winter Games in 1984. Senegal and Egypt joined Morocco, and Senegalese alpine skier Lamine Gaye became the first black African to compete at the Olympic Winter Competition. And after this, African athletes continued to push boundaries at the Winter Olympics, breaking new ground. Among these pioneers was Philip Boyd, who became Kenya's first Olympian at the Winter Games. Boyd made his debut in Nagano 1998, just 2 years after he experienced snow for the first time. And while he didn't win, the winner of that round, Norwegian Bjørn Dehili, delayed his appearance at the medal ceremony to first congratulate Boyd on his effort. Their embrace at the finish remains an iconic image of the Games. In 2018, Team Nigeria sent an all-women team to Pyeongchang, becoming the first African nation to participate in the 2-woman bobsleigh at the Games. And Simadele Adegbo became the first black African to compete in the skeleton race. Now, you might be wondering why there aren't more African countries competing at the Winter Olympics, especially since they do so well in the Summer Games. Well, challenges African athletes face have long been about the very hot climate in Africa and the inability to participate in winter sport. Any aspiring athletes would have to train outside of Africa most of the time, which is also why many young Africans end up taking up sports like skiing and snowboarding when studying or working abroad. But that isn't the only challenge preventing countries from taking part this year. COVID-19 has made it especially difficult and is stopping some hopefuls from competing in the Games. For example, in Kenya, 3 of its Olympians are no longer able to honour their qualifications this year due to travel restrictions. Now, at this point, you might be wondering what African countries you might be seeing at the Games. Well, there will be some new and old faces that you should be looking out for. Among them is Shannon Abida. He will be returning to the Games, representing Eritrea once more in alpine skiing.
So this will be a Winter Olympics like no other. And that's not just the athletic achievement. Holding an event like this in a pandemic is a major undertaking. Andre is here to tell us more. So Andre, What measures have been put in place to protect the competitors?
So China have adopted something called a zero COVID approach. Now, this is a bit different to what you'll see elsewhere in the world who are trying to live with COVID. China are trying to say no cases at all within their country. So in Beijing, in practice, there was an outbreak a few weeks ago. The authorities immediately said that everyone in that area had to be tested and those who were positive had to be locked down. With athletes, we've seen in that report that some aren't able to travel because of COVID or train. Those that have made it into the country are put in what we call bubbles. That means they have to train together, they have to travel together in special bubble trains where they won't be brought into contact with members of the public, and the hotels they stay in are just their group. In the general population, if you're driving along and you crash into a car carrying athletes, you're not even allowed to go over to help them to make sure that that infection isn't spread around at all in the slightest. Now, when it comes to watching the games, if you watch previous Winter Olympics, you'll see fans cheering along from the side of the ski slopes and the ice rinks. That won't happen. It's only specially invited guests who are all very COVID tested beforehand are allowed to come along. The general public, they can't buy tickets at all.
So I understand some people think these games shouldn't be taking place in China at all.
Yeah, so the games have been, they have been boycotted of a fashion. So if I say boycott, you might imagine that the athletes aren't travelling or training or participating in the games. That's not the case. Countries like the UK, the US, Canada, Australia, they've done what's called a diplomatic boycott. So that means dignitaries and government officials won't be attending the games. Now, why have they done this? It's over human rights concerns, particularly in an area in the north of the country called Xinjiang, which is home to a large number of Uyghur Muslims. That's an ethnic group. And there are fears there that Uyghur Muslims are being discriminated against by the Chinese government. Also down in the south of the country, in an area called Hong Kong, there has been pro-democratic crackdowns by the government against citizens there. China denies this and says it's not in the spirit of the Olympic Games for them to be boycotted by these foreign dignitaries.
Well, thank you, Andre. Now, you'll probably be aware that the Winter Olympics isn't the only massive sport event going on at the moment. Yes, the Africa Cup of Nations is happening in Cameroon. And what a tournament it's been, with teams like Gambia and the Comoros Islands getting further than expected. But they've not been the only shocks, with big names like Ghana and Nigeria being knocked out at the early stages. But maybe the biggest surprise of all was seeing the reigning champions, Algeria, eliminated in the first round. So where did it all go wrong for the Desert Foxes? Nora has been finding out.
This was the reaction of Algerian fans 3 years ago, after Algeria won AFCON 2019. There was excitement everywhere, so it was no surprise that the Desert Foxes were one of the favourites to win this year's AFCON 2021. With stars like Manchester City's Riyad Mahrez in their squad, surely they couldn't lose. However, they were eliminated in the group phase after losing to Equatorial Guinea and Ivory Coast and drawing with Sierra Leone. So how have Algeria fans responded to their defeat?
We lost after a strike of 35 matches. We are sad but not disappointed. Algeria will come back stronger and stronger.
I'm not sad because it's football at the end of the day. You win some as well as you lose some.
I'm a bit disappointed in Algeria because we have lost two matches in the African Cup. But we are still the champions of African Cup 2019 and Arab Cup 2021.
I was really disappointed in seeing that Riyad Mahrez, my favorite player, performed really poorly and didn't score even a goal. But I'm sure we'll come back stronger, and in 2022 we hope to qualify in the World Cup.
So we've heard from the fans, but what do the experts say?
There are so many reasons why Algeria didn't really pull it off and make it to the next round of this Africa Cup of Nations. The main reason is really a lack of execution in front of goal. Algeria were creating chances, they were holding onto the ball, they finished second in the tournament in possession, second in the tournament in terms of shots, but they couldn't necessarily put the ball into the back of the net. Now that may come down to the poor form of their strikers like Islam Slimani or Baghdad Bounedjah, or it may also come down to the shoddy preparation before the tournament. You have to remember that many of the Algerian players did not join the Algerian national team training camp until 2 or 3 days before the tournament. Captain Riyad Mahrez did not join his team until here in Cameroon. And on top of all of that, there were also several COVID cases that plagued the Algerian national team.
But Algeria do have a chance to redeem themselves, though. They play Cameroon in March over two legs, with the winners qualifying for the World Cup in Qatar later this year.
Now, it's known as the second lung of the world, but it's fast disappearing. And some estimates even say that in 80 years' time, it could be gone. We're talking about the Congo rainforest, home to 600 types of trees and 10,000 animal species. Sadly, though, in the last 30 years, the Democratic Republic of Congo has lost 18% of its forest. Much of it is burnt to provide power to some of the country's more than 105 million residents. So what can be done to help save the rainforest? Elodie sent this report from Mbandaka in the northeast of the country.
Like most Congolese women, when Josie prepares food for her family, she uses charcoal.
That's how we do it here. We prepare everything with coal. Since we don't have electricity very often, we make do with coal.
We are here at the power plant of Mbandaka, the one supposed to electrify the whole city. But as you can see, the engines have completely stopped. Only one generator continues to work, but only for a few hours a day, burning 100 liters of fuel.
What adds to the problem is fuel is very expensive, so many are turning to the forest. Almost half of Africa's tropical rainforests are here, but they are disappearing quickly. The DRC has one of the highest rates of deforestation in the world. In the last 20 years, an area bigger than the size of Malawi has disappeared. The main culprit? People cutting down trees for charcoal.
This is where we make coal. First we cut the trees and then we burn them. And after a few days we get coal. We make money from this, even though I noticed that we have fewer and fewer trees.
This is a particular problem for young people. According to a UNICEF report, children here are the ninth most vulnerable in the world for climate change. Trees absorb carbon from the air and turn it into oxygen. Therefore, when they are cut down and burnt, they release the stored carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. The Congo River is the second most powerful in the world in terms of flow. In Inga, where the country's two main dams are located, only 10% of the area's energy potential is used. It has been reported that Congo's government has been in talks to create one of the world's largest hydroelectric power plants, Grand Inga Dam. Could it be the harness to help the country's energy needs?
We are waiting for the polluting countries to put their hands in their pockets to finance the Inga Dam project. It will support the world. It will be the solution to meet the objective of reducing the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius.
Although the Grand Inga project has been under discussion for decades, construction has not yet begun. This is due to economic and political disagreements. But the DRC is going to have to move quickly if it wants to save the future of the lungs of the world.
You might have seen a 3D movie at the cinema where you put on special glasses and you are transported into a 3D dimensional world. Now, a young artist from South Africa has used this effect on his paintings. And as well as being a cool idea, the paintings look at important themes like African history, racism, and gender violence. Hannah went to see him at his exhibition in London.
My name is Giggs Khanamutsukhole. I'm a South African artist and I make 3D paintings.
Giggs Khole is 24 and this is his 12th solo exhibition. The blue and red lines in his pictures make them look three-dimensional when seen through 3D glasses. We've tried to recreate the effect here.
When you put on the 3D glasses, they become 3D films, and then when you move around, those 3D films move around with you.
Whoa. So tell me about what's going on here.
So my biggest statement here was like, stop killing our mothers. I was raised by a woman growing up, and those women really have like shaped the man that I've become. And when you witness things such as like femicide and gender-based violence, think that, you know, these like, this could be your mom, this could be your sister. With the river and the ocean that you see here, I highlight, you know, some of the bodies of these female figures who were thrown overboard during slavery. The females that managed to survive that, and they had to go through the plantations. They used things like braiding hair to write symbols and messages. And as well as this braided hair looked like palm trees to sort of like symbolize, you know, this ideal notion of like freedom and like a good life they would hope for their descendants would have. But unfortunately, females such as like Breonna Taylor are still like victims to police brutality.
Giggs was born in Kutupu village in Limpopo, South Africa. He started doing art when he was 4, making sculptures out of clay from the river. Now he uses art to talk about African history and racism in the art world.
I've always looked through art history, and I haven't seen people like myself documented. So I believe that it's very important for like people like myself and people in my generation to really document our histories in order to kind of set a statement that, you know, we exist and we do contribute to the world. With the works that you see, they are black, and that's because I'm black, but the topics are international. They can touch any living soul out there.
Some of his pictures feature QR codes that can be scanned with a smartphone and take you to a website with more information about the piece.
So technology is a big thing because I'm a huge nerd. From the first time I got to use like the internet when I was 14 years old, I was always fascinated on how tech was used to create sort of imagery, how tech is used within art. So then I taught myself, between 14 and 18 years old, as I taught myself how to make 3D movies and then turn those 3D movies into still images.
Wow.
The colored lenses trick your brain into seeing a different picture through each eye, which it interprets as 3D. They can be a bit much.
You don't get a headache.
I do.
Wow, they're so intense.
Yeah. When Giggs was 14, he had his first solo exhibition. At the age of 21, he became the youngest gallerist in South Africa at the time.
What was it like when you first told your dad you wanted to be an artist?
I think it was quite scary, especially like, you know, trying to explain to like an African dad that you want to paint and him not understanding what painting is or creating art was. I was like, Dad, you know, all I really need in life is just your love and support.
Nowadays, not only has he got his family support, he's able to support them.
The maximum I've sold a painting for is, it was £16,000.
After this exhibition, he's returning to Rome, in Italy, to finish a degree in art history.
Now, did you know that Nama Damara, the language spoken by some tribes in parts of southern Africa, is one of the oldest languages on the continent? One singer from Namibia has made it her mission to keep the language alive by singing some of her harmonies in Nama Damara. Taylor J spoke to Nyasha Michelle about why she uses her language in traditional fashion to keep her Namibian heritage and culture alive.
Always wonder, okay, you don't say certain things on social media, you don't do certain things on your post it on your social media. I'm like, exactly, because I know people are watching. I'm a superhero. What message, who am I inspiring, what am I putting out? You know, if a little girl is sitting and watching my page, you get me, do I want her to imitate certain things? No.
Welcome to BBC What's New. How are you doing?
I'm good, man. How are you?
I'm good. Let's talk music first. You sing in one of Africa's oldest unique languages, Nama Damara. Why is it important for you to keep it alive?
I decided to start singing in Nama Damara, which is called Khoisan, the Khoisan tribal languages.
no one knows about it. You know, people kind of know the languages that derive from it, but no one knows the root, you know, the root that it's a San people. It's a San people from Namibia, it's a San people from South Africa. So I wanted to shed light to it and add it into, you know, the twang that I do with English and everything, and then it sounds cool and all that. So it's my duty, you know, to showcase my heritage, to keep my culture alive.
So in addition to carrying your Namibian flag high, you also style yourself in your music videos. What message does your style send to your fans?
I'm always try to just be myself, you know, and I'm very, very hands-on. So since when I started doing my music videos, I've always wanted to do my own designs. For me, when I step on stage, I feel like there's like an extension of myself that comes out, because off stage, I'm quite shy. But when I'm on stage or when I'm in the studio, there's like something like an alter ego that kind of comes out. Jay Walker kind of just organically came, and the fashion, everything just works with it.
So you're quite the entrepreneur. In addition to owning your own clothing brand, you also own your own music label. What challenges did you face doing that? But also, what freedoms did it give you?
Being the business side of my company and being the artist, I always have to constantly split my brain, you know, so that's where the challenge comes in. So I've had to learn things on the way. As I'm sitting here, I own all the rights of my music, which a lot of artists don't have. I definitely urge young girls to own everything that you're doing, you know, be confident. Don't expect anyone to give it to you on a silver platter. Work hard for it. There's a lot of work that is behind the scenes. I know it looks very glamorous, but that's just what you see in one day. You have to be willing to put in the work, and in the long term, it will pay off.
You founded the First Ladies Foundation, which aims to fight gender-based violence. Why did you feel that this was a necessary cause to fight for?
Right now in Namibia and in South Africa, the GBV pandemic is on a rise, and I also have family members and stuff that have gone through this, so I just felt like it's important. What can I do? And we started doing a series of get-togethers every week where I would bring influential females sitting down and having panel discussions. You know, social media is powerful. That person that you follow, if you see them telling their stories, whoever watches them will have the courage to be able to talk about it, because my goal is the more people we can get to actually seek help, that's the way we can cut it. I was the first Namibian musician to perform at the One Africa Dubai Fest, and it was a great moment because that's always been my goal, to bring Namibian music to the forefront, kind of like what we call our urban culture, you know, and this is like Namibia.
I see.
This is the, yeah, so whenever people do this, it means Nam Life. We have our own culture, and it comes through in our music, you know. Just listen to it. Just have to listen to it.
Whoa, I'm feeling that. Well, that's all from us for now. But the good news is, if you miss us, don't forget that in the meantime, you can find more from What's New on our YouTube channel. Just go on to youtube.com/BBC What's New. Make sure you hit that subscribe button to keep up to date with all our latest interviews and stories. And please comment on your favorite ones. See you next time. Bye.